In the modern history of God's church, Portland, Oregon is a special place set in one of the Earth's most beautiful places. The story of the Portland congregations of the Worldwide Church of God is a story of a family of God's people in the modern world. It is also a story of family firsts because it was here that God led to the first conversions of the Philadelphia era. It was here that Herbert and Loma Armstrong were called, converted, and tested in the truth of God. It is here that the heritage of the Worldwide Church of God began in the 20th century. Now, congregations like our four here in Portland are spread over all the earth. As God's worldwide family knit together under Mr. Joseph Tkach, another apostle of God's choosing, we celebrate our family heritage that began here and has now grown worldwide. We acknowledge the foundations of God's truth which enrich the entire church as we do God's will at the end of an age. Like Mr. Tkach, Herbert and Loma Armstrong had roots in Chicago and the Midwest. As a young man, Mr. Armstrong built a brilliant career in advertising and in journalism in Chicago. But for some reason, all his business collapsed. After years of frustration, he moved to Portland, Oregon with his family in 1924. Once again, he began building a promising business of advertising in Portland. Again, this was wiped out.
Hello, my name is Glenn White. I'm again privileged to be the pastor of the Vancouver, Washington Church. This is the home of the Columbian newspaper, where Mr. Armstrong received his first employment after arriving in Oregon. He did a survey for the owner and was then hired as a consultant. As Mr. Armstrong remained in the area, he did surveys and for certain retail stores and began to build a business. All of his business enterprises collapsed, and this then left Mr. Armstrong quite humiliated and very frustrated. Here we are in front of the Portland Public Library. Now, after Mr. Armstrong's businesses had been swept away, and he had subsequently been challenged by Mrs. Loma Armstrong on the subject of the Sabbath, this is where he went in depth into the studies of evolution, on the Bible, and of course the Sabbath question itself. Mrs. Armstrong had been influenced by a Church of God Seventh-day member concerning the Sabbath question. She, in turn, had challenged Mr. Armstrong, and that led to his studies here. Well, Mr. Armstrong had always believed that there was a God, but he had never really proven it. So through the circumstances in his private life and through his studies here, Mr. Armstrong was led to conversion. So in a very, very real sense, God was preparing Mr. Armstrong for his work in the Philadelphia era here in this very library here in Portland. This, in essence, then was the beginning of his in-depth studies, which led to the Philadelphia era. It was in these rooms and with these books that Mr. Armstrong sought out the existence of God and the proof of the Bible. Mr. Armstrong was a man who believed in intellectual honesty, and he pursued this, and it was here that he did arrive at these major conclusions. And as he was led in his studies and God began to work with his mind, he surrendered his life to Jesus Christ.
Often returning here, Mr. Armstrong conceived of the Plain Truth magazine in 1927, his first year of conversion. In those years of deep poverty, Mr. Armstrong lived in various rental houses, including one on this street at 75th and Sandy in East Portland. He sold wherever cookware from this location on Sandy Boulevard, a few blocks from his home. 85-year-old member of the Portland East congregation, Iantha Cook, remembers Mr. Armstrong then.
It was around 1930 or 31, someplace in there, that we bought the aluminum. And I, at that time, I believe Mr. Armstrong was living in Portland. Mr. Armstrong, I'm sure it was him, gave this just was a demonstration. I mean, he just told about how wonderful this cookware was and how it was so healthy. And everybody just seemed to really pick up on it, you know. And I'm sure that, if I could remember right, that most everyone bought a set, or I know several that did, and I think the ones that didn't buy the whole set bought pieces of it. And I'd like to show you some of it, if you'd like to see it. This is one of the kettles, and I still use. And this was one of the demonstrations. These are the few that I have left. And this was a gift for having a dinner.
Mr. Armstrong recognized the humble members of the Sabbath-keeping Church of God as the true church. Loosely organized under a headquarters in Stanbury, Missouri, various groups of the church met around Portland and the Willamette Valley. Mr. Armstrong gave his first sermon in 1928 to a group of 12 Sabbath keepers after a 2-mile walk up this hill at the end of the trolley line in Oregon City. Often he didn't have car fare to the top. Initially discussing baptism, Mr. Armstrong often talked with Arvid Stith, a farmer and minister of the Church of God. Arvid Stith's 85-year-old niece, Mrs. Joseph Rothery, is now a member of the Portland East congregation.
I was born in Joplin, Missouri, and I think my mother was baptized about when I was about a year old. Sort of a miracle happened about that time, and the minister prayed for her. And I was only weighed about 4 pounds, so she just about lost her life, which would have been mine too, you see. So we had this, at that time there was my two uncles and this Mr. Blackman. We used to call him brother, you know, Brother Stith and Brother Smith. And so they kept these little meetings going then, you know. And then in 1917, when Mr. Stith and one of my two uncles and their families moved to Washington and started up a little churches there, the Church of God, he felt he was called to come and start churches on the West Coast. So then they went to the Boise Valley and started up the first church up there. So I just kept in contact with them. We came out here then in 1918, the next year. And there were no churches. But this was long before the splits. It was still the Stanbury Church up till, I believe, around in the early 30s, somewhere around the time Mr. Armstrong started. We moved to Medford right after that. And we met with my cousin and her husband who kept the Sabbath, who was a minister in the Church of God, Seventh Day. And we met with them while we were there, both of us. And they'd come to our house or we would go to their home. And then we moved back to Portland. And that's when I heard Mr. Armstrong on the radio and I said, that sounds like the true church. So to me, it was always the true church, God, even though I didn't have a church to go to.
Mr. Armstrong was ordained into the ministry of the Church of God in 1931 and was briefly employed by the Oregon Conference of the Church. He then took a job as advertising manager of a newspaper in Astoria for the next 15 months, a decision he later said was a tragic mistake. But God wanted him in the full-time ministry. In 1933, he was again employed by the Oregon Conference in the Eugene area with a salary of $3 per week. After launching both the radio broadcast and Plain Truth in Eugene in early 1934, Portland was the first large city to feel the impact of God's work under Mr. Armstrong. The work grew rapidly from his small second floor office in Eugene, where Mrs. Starkey was Mr. Armstrong's secretary. In 1936, Mr. Armstrong began broadcasting weekly from KXL and 1 year later on KWJJ in Portland. By the early 1940s, people were interested in God's truth all over the Northwest, but Mr. Armstrong was the only minister of this work. God called the earliest members of the Portland Congregation of the Worldwide Church of God in the 1930s, including the Starkeys, Robert and Mary Baer, Mrs. Baer's sister Crystal Allworth, and Basil and Honor Wolverton.
Hello. I'm Richard Starkey from the Portland West congregation. I'm the son of Mr. and Mrs. Starkey that started back in the fall of 35. My mother was Mr. Armstrong's first secretary in the work in the late 30s. I was born in 1938 in the fall, just before the Feast of Tabernacles. And when I became 2.5 years old, we moved to Orchards, Washington in 1941. At that time, we were going to the church in Vancouver, Washington, and then approximately 1947, there were several people, more people in the Portland area, so we started meeting in different brethren's homes, and Mrs. Bodenheimer and Mrs. Larson and Grandma Johnson is what we used to call her because she was the oldest one of the congregation. And Mr. Wilberton conducted the services and kept it going. In the early years of the church, in the early 40s, I was the only child, and it was quite lonely to be the only child, no one to talk to or to relate to. And so in 1948, Mr. Wilberton's, they had a child named Monty. And then in 1950, the funds from Gresham, Oregon started attending church, and they had 3 children. And I thought that was just great. And then from then on, the children started coming and it grew from there. In 1957, I was the first boy to graduate from Imperial School in Pasadena.
Well, we came in, we was married in 1937, and then we came in the church in 1938. And it was day after Passover that we came in. We came in to see Mr. Armstrong, and it was at the KWJJ studio. My mother-in-law had found him on a broadcast station. They had an old battery set clear up in the mountains. And they heard his broadcast, and they're pretty interested in it. And at that time they had no way of checking up on it except their Bibles. So we went into the main library in Portland, and did quite a bit of research for him. Then we'd write a letter back telling them what we'd found.
Yes, we did. We lived where we could walk to the main library in Portland, and we spent quite a few hours checking the things out, and then we would write back to my mother and say yes, he was right. And one the thing that my mother said when she first contacted us was, I think I've found what we're all looking for.
When we met Mr. Armstrong, I thought at first that it was his church, and it was quite a few years later before I realized that he was just a tool used by God to form the church. And it was quite some time before I could get it out of my head that Mr. Armstrong wasn't really the head of the church. And I think he's the one that actually taught me that. And he helped get it out of my head, because once I get something in my head, it's just a little hard to kick out.
I don't recall thinking that he himself was the head of the church. I think I had it pretty straight.
During the early days, I don't think we really realized what the work was going to grow into. Because at that time, I've had a little talk with Mr. Armstrong just shortly after we met him. It wasn't too long afterward. And we didn't have a lot of membership, probably 30 up where we were at the very most. Now, I had a little talk with Mr. Armstrong. We was talking about it, where we probably had about 100 people in the church. And if with a lot of work and with a lot of help, we might get 1,000 in the church. But we had no idea how we'd do it.
Yes, Mr. Armstrong himself, when he realized that he was going to branch out from the Portland area and go up into Seattle, he began to get a little larger view of it. And then he realized that maybe we would take in the whole West Coast.
Personally, I looked at it because we needed ministers. I knew that, because where we were, we'd only see Mr. Armstrong every 2 weeks or once a month, and it wasn't enough. We needed more contact with the ministers. And I think that was the main reason that I was for the college, because I could see the need for more help.
But like Bob said, we needed ministers, because in our little group, some of the people would invite other radio ministers to come and talk to us, and some of them followed the wrong people. And so we knew that we needed some. Mr. Wolverton was an elder, and if it hadn't been for Mr. Wolverton, maybe more would have gone. But he held the group together.
Basil Wolverton and his wife Honor became pillars in the fledgling congregation of the church in Portland. Deeply dedicated and converted, Basil Wolverton was also known for his brilliant humor and graphic design. He also wrote the Bible story in multiple volumes for children, which was published by the church. His only son, Monty, is now design director for all publications of the work in Pasadena. Honor Wolverton describes the events of the earliest years when she and Basil began listening to Mr. Armstrong in 1936.
And so it was 1940 in March before Mr. Armstrong got around to visiting us. He liked the idea of, since he was disillusioned with religion, he liked the idea of Mr. Armstrong comparing prophecy of the Bible with the current events that were happening. He was baptized November 23rd, 1940, in the Columbia River over by Jansen Beach. Jansen Beach wasn't in existence then. And it was a real cold, blustery, awful day, raining, pelting down, real cold. Mr. Armstrong wore his rubber suit and went out where it was pretty deep and didn't seem to bother him any. We didn't have any minister except when Mr. Armstrong would come up. And so all we'd have is, we had some really funny things that happened. I don't know whether people didn't take, the few of us that were there didn't take Basil seriously or what, but it never seemed to bother him any. I remember one time Mrs. Shepherd asked Mr. Pauli to speak. Chloe was always bringing on surprises like that. And so this one time when we were in Redmond Hall and Dwight Armstrong and Grandma Armstrong came up, she said, "Basil, I've asked Mrs. Pauli to speak." And he was so surprised that he kind of hem and hawed, and I guess I don't think he realized that that Mrs. Pauli was going to have a sermon. Well, we were in this little tiny room, and it was right next to the outside wall, and she had a real loud voice. And so she spoke, and you could hear every word she said outdoors, and she got really Pentecostal, kind of. And so when it was over with, why, Basil said, "Well, boy, I didn't know that was going to happen." He said, "It's never going to happen again." So he called Mr. Armstrong. When he got home, he called Mr. Armstrong and said, "We had a new minister today." And he said, "Who?" Basil told him, "Well, Mrs. Pauli spoke." And Mr. Armstrong laughed. He says, "I bet that was Chloe's idea." And Basil said, "Well, yes, she had it all planned." He said, "I didn't want to embarrass the woman and say you can't talk." So he said, "I'll let her go ahead with it." And he said, "Oh, I'm going to have a talk with that woman, you know, Chloe." He knew her real well. and says, she's not to do that again. She just can't get it. Said she should have been a minister. If women were allowed to be ministers, she would be one. But that was real, kind of sad in a way, but funny.
I think Mr. Armstrong was made the agent, so to speak, to promote God's work. And he was blessed with finding out all the knowledge that he did when he studied to get into the work full time and to preach the truth. Otherwise, he would have been still with that other outfit and probably right there today, two or three in the church. With not a big group.
To Mr. Armstrong and the brethren, the coming of World War II had obvious prophetic significance. Would Hitler and Mussolini usher in the prophesied tribulation and the day of the Lord? From its first issue, The Plain Truth always asked such intriguing questions at the cutting edge of world news. Just as the world was plunging into its most horrible war, God's end-time proclaiming of the gospel burst out of its Oregon birthplace. From 1939 to 1945, America was stunned by the war events in Europe and the Pacific. During those 6 years, the work grew from coverage of one state to the entire United States. On December 7, 1941, while flying from Seattle on his first airplane trip, Mr. Armstrong heard that the Japanese had destroyed the American fleet a few hours before at Pearl Harbor. After buying the latest newspapers, he rushed to KWJJ's offices in Portland and gave his red-hot broadcast about the war. Thereafter, basically using only news analysis and commentary format for the radio. Still, the brethren in Portland remained a keystone of support of his work. Throughout the 1940s, as the work's media went national, Mr. Armstrong spent less time in Oregon and more in the American media capital of Hollywood. The brethren in Portland saw him only occasionally. With people all over the United States responding to the work, Mr. Armstrong was unable to personally build churches to satisfy the spiritual needs of those God would call through his work. He knew even before the war ended that trained ministers would be needed. The brethren in Portland were learning along with Mr. Armstrong that God's work would be constantly expanding. The atomic bomb marked the end of World War II and the speeding up of events that would transform the world. With Plain Truth and media coverage soaring, Mr. Armstrong and the brethren gained a global vision of the work's potential in the world after the war. After Ambassador College was founded, the first students trained under Mr. Armstrong would often come to Portland to meet new prospective members during the summers. In the early 50s, services were held in members' homes until the numbers became too large by the mid-1950s. During this time, many who later went to Ambassador College as students were called into God's church in Portland. These included evangelists Leroy Neff, Leslie McCullough, Dean Wilson, and their wives. As the second church congregation established since beginning the work in this era, many of the church's evangelists and ministers have pastored here. The church grew and prospered over the decades since the college started. By the late 1950s, there were about 100 in the congregation, with 300 by the late 60s. To the original Portland congregation, now known as Portland West, Vancouver was added in the early 1970s and Portland East in the late 1970s. Hood River became a separate congregation in the mid-1980s. Now, approximately 1,200 members and their families meet weekly in the Portland area.
We missed seeing the Armstrongs, and we missed having them up here. But as far as the other thing, we were for it, because he had this great dream of having a college and really going forward so that we could, so that the young people could be trained into what the Bible told us and what the Bible tells us. So we were for it. we miss seeing the Armstrongs, but then people have to move, and so that seemed the best move for them. And for the church in general, I think. It has to grow, otherwise it gets stagnant.
Well, that's the only thing he could do. I mean, he couldn't handle that alone. Look at where would it have been now if he hadn't started the college and trained ministers and trained their wives to go along with him. That was wonderful. Everything was exciting.
At this time, thinking back 50 years, of course, we can't think back that far, because it was only in January of 1951 that my wife and I first heard Mr. Armstrong. And then several months later, in August of 1951, we attended our first service. One of the main reasons why we attended that particular service was that we had heard that Mr. Herbert Armstrong would be speaking there, that he was visiting in Oregon, had been over to the Oregon coast for a few days, and would be stopping by the Portland church. The service, of course, was rather strange to us. Mr. Armstrong had a very long sermon. It seems like it was the longest sermon that we had ever heard by far. And during the sermon, I know he talked about various services that they had had at the Feast of Tabernacles and the Days of Unleavened Bread, and I remember how strange it was to hear those words, even though we had been reading our Bibles all of our lives. We had never remembered particularly those particular things in the Bible. We certainly enjoyed our service, the service there. I remember Mr. Wolverton had the opening prayer, and not only was the sermon the longest sermon we'd ever heard, but I think that the prayer was the longest prayer we'd ever heard. We thought, though, it was very sincere and very much from the heart, and we came to respect and love Mr. Wolverton and, of course, his wife, Honor, very, very much. Then, after the service, we met Mr. Armstrong, talked to him a little while. The next Sabbath, we came back again. All of the visitors were not there, and I think that there were only about 25 of us, including our family of five. So I guess we increased the church about 25% by our five and our family attending services.
In 1951, the Neff family started attending the church, and they had a son named Larry Neff, which is a pastor of the Sacramento church area. And he was sitting in the front row and got caught reading comic books, and I was lucky I was sitting in the back and didn't get caught. But this was Mr. McNair is the one that mentioned it and caught it and talked to us and told us to shape up.
No.
He got caught and I didn't. Because I was in the back and he was in the front.
I was happy about starting the college, yes. And Marion was had two more years of high school, I think. And I'm going to college, you know. So when Les went down there, Mrs. Armstrong said, "Well, Marion, why didn't you ever come down to college?" She says, "I don't know, Mrs. Armstrong. I guess because I met Les, and I guess he was supposed to come."
I first heard Mr. Armstrong when I was a teenager, and that would have been in about 1945. I was living in Minnesota on the farm and had the farm paper radio log and saw The World Tomorrow, thinking it was some kind of a space or show or something. I was interested, so I tuned it in and found it was a religious show. Time went on, close to a year before I realized I needed to be baptized. I realized my baptism as an infant was not valid. I needed to be repentant and know what I was doing when I was baptized, and so I wrote in for baptism. About 4 months later, Mr. and Mrs. Raymond McNair showed up at our door. one Friday afternoon, and he sat down and talked to us both my husband and I, and I had to tell him that my husband really wasn't interested.
And yes, I was in the room, and I listened to Mr. McNair talking to my wife, asking the questions. I heard the answers, and I got angry. I got up, left the room, went to the basement, and I listened at the registers to hear the rest of the conversation, and I got more angry. And I then left the place. I got in the car and left, went uptown. And when I came back, Mr. Raymond McNair was just leaving. And that was certainly a cause of time of turmoil. And I, at that time, loved to eat pork steak. That was my favorite. And we had a bunch of pork steak in the house, and he told her, "Now, don't, you're not supposed to do that." So she came home from Sabbath services one day, and I got pork steak out, and she wouldn't cook it. So I cooked it myself, and then the kids wouldn't eat it either, so I ate it all, which was quite a few pieces, and I got sick from it. I didn't ever eat pork steak after that. I mean, maybe that's a way of God curing me from eating the meat. I used to take her to church and sit outside. And I would watch all these people coming out. And one day I asked her, I said, "What kind of people go there to that church?" She said, "Well, they're just a bunch of people that are trying to build character." And I said, "They sure look like a bunch of character." So my entering the church had nothing really to do whether I believed it is right or wrong, but I just didn't want the family disintegrate. And as I, of course, then I got studying and involved in the different things, and then I was convinced that it was right away. The Spokesman's Club started. I believe the first one out of Pasadena started in Portland. I believe it had to be in late 58. Mr. Burt McNair, I believe, was the first, was the one here for the first club. When we started, Vivian, of course, she came in first, but when I started tending, there were about 70 to 75 people, which would include Vancouver, Hood River, and all of Portland. And we continued then with the one church. Earlier, we even had the whole spring festival here, the whole 7 days. We would come from Canada, Alaska, Montana, Idaho, all of Oregon, Washington. Then, of course, at that time, the feast was held in one place in Big Sandy, and then, I believe, in 62 in Squaw Valley. Well, it continued with one church until probably 72 to 74 when the Vancouver church started. Then the East church started in later 70s. I was ordained in Pentecost of 69. Mr. McCullough and Mr. Carlton Smith in Salem at the Feast of Pentecost. In 1982, we went to the refresher course. Mr. Joe DeCotch was then in charge of the ministerial services, and he was in charge of the refresher course. And that was the first time in all of the times that we'd gone to the conference or the refreshers, and I think that would be the first refresher that we went to, that I felt the peace and the quietness. It felt like an umbrella of peace over Ambassador College. And the trust was in total agreement with what we had learned through all these years of Mr. Armstrong's work. Only thing, it was a mushrooming, it was a building, and it was harmony with that.
Oh, I think it was a wonderful transition. I just feel that you hardly knew there was any, because he kept things going about in the same way that Mr. Armstrong would. And I understand Mr. Armstrong asked him to keep things going the way he had you know, he was handling things for a while, which is a normal way to do things, I think. I think it was a beautiful transition. And I think everybody's really, and the way it was handled and the way he appointed him to be leader of our group, it couldn't have been handled any better way. And I think Mr. Takash is doing a beautiful job.
I think that we have seen God's hand in the work all through the years, but the longer we've been in, the more we can realize what it is that we're seeing. And when we see the newer developments, and I think what impressed me the most was when Mr. Armstrong died and God had prepared Mr. Takash to come in and do the work, take over the next phase of the work, and how he is such a perfect person to do it. And you can certainly see God's hand in that.
The intent is for, and I think that's been the intent for everybody who's been over these years, stable and sound in the church. The intent is this is God's church, and it's a growing church, it's a learning church, and it's a changing church, and it's a maturing church. And Mr. Armstrong had laid a foundation which has to come in building a building. And now Mr. Joe Takash, in his work, is building the building, building the structure. Mr. Armstrong had laid the foundation and they put up some of the pillars and such. Mr. Takash is continually building the structure now in the unity of the body of the family.
We wish you the best of everything. Hope that you'll not only have 50 more years, but you'll have 5 million or 5,000 years as a part of God's church throughout all eternity. So the best wishes to me and my wife, to you, and we'll look forward to seeing you sometime, hopefully soon.
Like a great mountain set in a beautiful place, God's truth and kingdom are to cover the earth. God's church and family was never to be limited to one time, one place, or a small handful of people. It is ultimately the heritage of all people. Though a small seed, like the mustard seed, was planted in Portland in 1927, it was to grow far beyond and cover the earth. There is much new and exciting that awaits God's people who remain faithful to truth and the inspired leadership God has provided. So congratulations to God's people in Portland. With your brethren around the world, God is making you his city on a hill. As God's children, you shine as lights, and your light has been shining in the darkness of this world for 50 years in Portland, a darkness that soon will end with the coming of the kingdom of God.